In this video, I'll walk you through the steps of setting up a sound system for a live event. I'll help you avoid the most common mistakes, and by the end of the video, you'll have a great sounding system. The process explained in this video will apply to any system you might be using, but I'll be demonstrating the process using the Mackie SRM V-Class loudspeakers, DRM 18S subwoofers, and the Pro FX 12 V3 Plus mixer. Thanks to Mackie for sponsoring this video and supporting audio education. Links to each of these products can be found in the description below the video. Let's start by planning the room layout. It's important to put things in place before making connections with cables. That way, you can keep cable pathways as clean as possible, which will make troubleshooting and loadout much faster. There are three things that you should pay special attention to in this phase: speaker placement, mixer location, and cable pathways. When considering speaker placement, your goal is to place the speakers so that everyone in the audience can hear while also preventing microphone feedback. In most live audio contexts, it's also important that the speakers do not obstruct the view of the stage from the audience. To accomplish this, I'll usually recommend placing the speakers on either side of the stage facing the audience. For a more detailed explanation of speaker placement, check out the video I made with Michael Curtis using the link below the video. If you have speaker stands, you'll be able to place the speakers higher so that the sound will reach everyone in the audience rather than just the people in the front row. To avoid microphone feedback, place the speakers so that the microphones on stage will be behind them. If you place the microphones in front of the speakers, you won't be able to turn them up as much before they begin feeding back, and nothing ruins a performance like the squealing sound of mic feedback. In many situations, you'll be using subwoofers in addition to main speakers, and there are several ways to approach subwoofer placement. One basic method is to place the subwoofer in front of the stage, or in a cluster in front of the stage if you're using multiple subs. This method will often provide very uniform coverage of the audience. Alternatively, you might choose to place the subs below the main speakers on either side of the stage. For this, it sometimes makes sense to mount the main speakers on the subs using a pole. Next, decide where to place the mixer. Ideally, the mixer will be in the audience area so that you can hear what the audience is hearing while using the mixer. However, that's not always possible. In many cases, the best place for the mixer is to one side of the stage, as that keeps things out of the way and also reduces the need for long cable runs and potential tripping hazards, as I'll mention in a moment. For some events, you'll need to hide the mixer away so it's completely out of sight. In these scenarios, you'll just have to find a spot for it based on the unique situation. Once you determine the location of the stage, the speakers, and the mixer, you'll need to determine the safest and most efficient pathways for cables to avoid tripping hazards. With this in mind, try to run cables along the walls and the stage whenever possible. And if you need to cross a doorway or another walkway, I've got a few options for you. One option is to go up and over the doorway, and another is to run cables along the floor, securing them to the floor with either cable ramps or gaff tape. Now that the speakers and the mixer are in place, it's time to run power to those locations. This is a good opportunity to verify that power is working so that you can ask the facilities team to turn it on while you've still got plenty of time before the show. You can either test power with a tool like this, or you can simply plug in and turn on the speakers or the mixer. Just make sure to turn everything off after verifying that power is working, because we'll turn things back on in a particular order once everything is connected. I'll show you how to do that later in the video when everything's set up. It's also a good idea to place some power drops on stage for the band or presenters to plug in instruments, amplifiers, and other devices. The next step is to normal the mixer or return all of the settings to their default positions. This helps to avoid any surprises that might have been left by the person who used it last, and it ensures you're working with a blank slate. Finally, we can start connecting things together. Let's start with the outputs. Throughout the show, you may want to listen to things in headphones so you can hear something without the audience needing to hear it. For this reason, I'd highly recommend using headphones, although they're not entirely necessary. If you choose to use headphones, connect them to the phone's output on your mixer. I usually recommend connecting the main outs of the mixer to the main speakers. In this case, I'll be using an XLR cable from the left output of this mixer to the input of the left speaker, and another XLR cable from the right output of the mixer to the right speaker. If your mixer has quarter inch output jacks instead, you can either use a long quarter inch TRS cable or a TRS to XLR adapter that will convert those outputs to XLR. There are different ways to connect subwoofers should you choose to use one. One way to connect a sub is to connect the main outs of the mixer directly to the input of the sub first, then connect the outputs of the subwoofer to the main speakers. In the case of the Mackie DRM18S subwoofer, there's a direct out, which will output a full range copy of the signal. And there's also a high pass out, which will output a high passed copy of the signal, containing mostly frequencies not produced by the sub. Using the high pass out provides a crossover between the main speakers and the subwoofer. You can learn more about crossovers with the link below to an Audio University post. Connecting the subs with this method, whether you choose to use the direct outs or the high pass outs, will mean that the content sent through the main outs of the mixer will be sent to both the subs and the mains. Some engineers prefer to run subs on an aux. To do this, you would run one of these auxiliary sends to the subwoofer, allowing you to separately control what channels are sent to the mains and to the subwoofers. You'll notice that the sends on this mixer are quarter inch TRS outputs. I'd recommend using a TRS to XLR male adapter here. Running subs on an aux is more of an advanced technique though, so I'd recommend feeding the subs and mains with the main outs unless you have a very specific intention that requires a more advanced setup. You might also need to provide monitor speakers so that the people on stage can hear themselves. If you are running monitor speakers, I'd recommend connecting them with the aux outputs of your console. In this case, we've got two monitor wedges, so I'll use the monitor send for one monitor and the FX send for another. This method will allow me to create two separate monitor mixes later on. If I only needed one monitor mix for all of the stage monitors, I could run a cable from the monitor send output of the mixer to the input of the first monitor, and then from the mix out of that monitor to the next stage monitor's input. No matter which setup you chose, at this point, it's time to power things on. I'd recommend turning on the mixer first and then turning on the speakers, as this will prevent clicks and pops that could damage the speakers. Now we'll connect the input devices to the mixer, including smartphones, instruments, and a couple different types of microphones. Let's start with a line level device, such as a smartphone, a laptop, etc. If the device is within 15 feet of the mixer, or about 4.5 meters, you can use a 3.5 millimeter to dual quarter inch TS adapter. But depending on the device, you may need an additional headphone adapter. These sorts of devices could be connected to any of these quarter inch line inputs on the mixer, but I'd recommend using one of the stereo inputs instead, as the stereo inputs will help you control both the left and right channel with only one channel strip on the mixer. Again, this adapter is a good choice for short distances only. For longer distances, you'll want to use a direct box. A direct box or DI box can be used in a few different ways. In general, a DI is helpful when connecting a high impedance or high Z source to a low Z or low impedance input on the mixer. Let's say the presenter on stage wants to play a video for the audience. The video is playing from a high Z output of a laptop, so the distance from the laptop to the mixer is too far for a simple adapter like the one I just showed you. Instead, you should use either a two-channel DI box or a pair of one-channel DI boxes, one for the left channel and one for the right channel. This will create a balanced connection from the stage to the mixer, which is much less susceptible to noise. DI boxes are also useful for connecting high impedance instruments like electric guitar or bass. Just plug the instrument into the DI box, plug the DI box into the mixer. And there's also a loop out of the DI box that can go directly to the musician's amplifier. If you're using an active DI box, you'll need to turn on phantom power on the mixer. Some mixers have a phantom power switch for each input. Other mixers have a single phantom power switch for all channels. Now let's look at how to connect microphones on stage. Most microphones you'll encounter are dynamic microphones. This means they don't require an external power source to function. You can connect a dynamic mic directly to one of the XLR inputs on the mixer. Condenser microphones do require an external power source, and in most cases, condenser mics get their power from the mixer through phantom power, just like an active DI box. At this point, you should have everything connected. The next step is to set the gain for each device and route the signals to the speakers using the mixer controls. This is where many people make mistakes, and the following process will help you to optimize the performance of your system. I like to start with the volume level on the speakers or amplifiers turned all the way down. Before bringing up any of the channel faders, set the main fader to unity, or 0 dB. This means the main fader will neither boost nor attenuate the signals sent through the main outputs. Next, play some music on the phone or laptop that's connected to the mixer. We can use headphones to set the input level of the music channel. Just press the PFL solo button at the bottom of the channel strip. This sends the signal to the phone's output, controlled by the phone's knob, and it also displays the input signal level on the main meters. Adjust the volume level of the music player or the gain knob at the top of the channel strip until the level averages at about 0 dB on the meter. Doing this ensures the gain structure within the mixer is optimized. Not too high to cause clipping or excessive distortion, but not too low to waste headroom or risk excessive noise. After verifying the signal level in headphones, carefully unmute the music channel and begin to slowly bring up the music channel fader to unity. You should start to see the output level on the main meters. If you don't see meters at this point, you might need to select the LR button at the bottom of the channel strip to route the signal to the main output. Note that you still won't hear anything coming through the speakers because they're currently turned all the way down. With the music playing, start to turn the volume knob on the speakers up until the music is at the appropriate loudness level for the audience. I'd recommend erring on the side of too loud rather than too quiet here, because you can always turn things down with the main fader or the individual channel faders. And once you've completed this step, your system will be optimized to provide adequate sound pressure level for the event based on a line level output. Next, let's go one by one through the input channels. For each input, we'll start with the fader all the way down and the channel muted. With someone playing the instrument or speaking into the microphone on stage, press the PFL solo button and set the gain knob until you reach an appropriate level on the main meter. This depends on the situation, but I'll usually aim for about 0 dB on a meter such as this one. If your meter only goes up to 0 dB FS, aim for about minus 12 dBFS. Then, route it to the main outs using the LR switch at the bottom of the channel strip. Ensure the channel is not muted and slowly bring up the fader toward unity. If every input is way too loud when the channel faders are at unity, you might consider turning down your speakers or amplifiers, or turning down the main fader. Ideally, you'll be mixing with the channel faders near unity, as this is where they offer the most control. A small adjustment toward the bottom of the fader's range will result in a much larger change in audio level compared to an equal adjustment toward the top of the fader's range. Through the course of boosting each signal to an appropriate level, you might experience some microphone feedback. Remember, the further the microphone is from the speakers, the more you can boost the signal without feedback. If you need some additional amplification and feedback is a problem, try engaging the high pass filter button at the top of the channel. If you still need more, you might want to try adding a subtractive EQ to remove problematic frequencies that are feeding back. I created a post about eliminating feedback that you might find helpful. I'll leave a link to that post in the description below the video. Eliminating a feedback with an EQ like this quickly requires a good ear. Your system should be optimized to sound as good as possible at this point. But before you go, I recommend downloading the free ear training guide at audiouniversityonline.com/eartrainingguide. It will not only help you improve your ear for mixing, but it will also really help when you're trying to eliminate those tones that keep feeding back. Thanks again to Mackie for sponsoring this video. And once you finish downloading that guide, come back here, because in the next video that's on your screen now, we'll go through every setting on the mixer to ensure that your show sounds as good as possible. I'll see you there.